Hello viewers, welcome to SDELMT Campus Online Learning Platform. Today, our topic of discussion is William Shakespeare's shortest and darkest tragedy, Macbeth. In this session, I am going to discuss short biographical sketch of William Shakespeare, a comparison of Shakespeare's Macbeth and the real historical Macbeth. Some important informations about the play, and most importantly, I will discuss the plot of the play in both of the languages, English and Bengali, for the purpose of better understanding of my followers. So, stay tuned. So friends, before discussing the play, let us have a look at some biographical informations about the playwright. William Shakespeare was born at Stratford-on-Avon on St. George's Day, April 23, 1564. He was the eldest son to John Shakespeare and his wife Arden. His family were gentle on both sides. Shakespeare was a good son as well, genial and generous friend. His parents shared his prosperity. In 1596, great sorrow fell upon him. His only son, Hamnet, died at the age of 11 years. It is supposed that Shakespeare quitted the stage finally in 1604. He had already attained comfortable fortune at the age of 40. After quitting, he cultivated his land and cherished his family. At the height of his prosperity, he enjoyed the favor of the queen and other noblemen who were also his friends. Some of his characters in his plays may have been inspired by the real noblemen. Queen Elizabeth had honored him with personal notice and favor. William Shakespeare expired on his birthday, April 23rd, in 1616, aged 52 years, because of an illness. Now guys, we have to know a few facts about the play Macbeth. Macbeth is among the best known of William Shakespeare's play, and there is no doubt about it. It is Shakespeare's shortest and darkest tragedy, believed to have been written between 1603 and 1606. The play was first performed at the Globe Theatre, London, and it was published in the first folio of 1623. Macbeth is a historical tragedy, but dear learners, you have to know that Macbeth, the hero of the play, in Shakespeare's imaginative version of the historical reality, is much different from real Macbeth, the historical personality. History tells us plain, the real Macbeth was the King of Scotland in between 1040 to 57 AD. He succeeded his father as governor of the province of Moray, 1031 AD. He was a military commander for Duncan I. In 1040, Macbeth killed Duncan in battle and seized the throne. Possibly of royal descent himself, he acquired a direct claim to the throne through his wife Gruach. She was a granddaughter of Kenneth III, who had been overthrown by Duncan's ancestor Malcolm II. Macbeth represented northern elements in the population who were opposed to the ties with the Saxons advocated by Duncan. Real Macbeth was defeated in 1054 by Siward, Earl of Northumbria, who regained the southern part of Scotland on behalf of Malcolm Duncanson. Malcolm himself regained the rest of the kingdom after defeating and killing Macbeth in the Battle of Lumphanan. He then succeeded to the throne as Malcolm III. So, dear friends, we can observe a kind of huge difference in between the historical truth and the historical character who is portrayed by William Shakespeare. What is not there in the play, The Tragedy of Macbeth? Supernatural, treachery, murders, bloodshed, faithlessness, deception, ambition, lust for power. Everything was there, and it was one of the most successful plays by William Shakespeare. Shakespeare must have conceived of Macbeth as a personality caught up between the old and the new world views and ethos. The conventional one and the Renaissance one. The former defined man's place on earth in terms of the biblical worldview presented in the first chapter of the Bible, Genesis, which necessarily linked to it the concept of great chain of being and accordingly dictated the codes of conduct. The latter, yet to come out fully, on the other, was trying to supplant the old ones with the new Renaissance one, which was slowly but surely encouraging man to think beyond the traditional framework towards the direction of fullest use of the human potentials. The audience or readers feel sympathetic to Macbeth not because he possesses the high stature of a tragic hero described by Aristotle. They understand that he is a villain and criminal, but at the same time they also share his vaulting ambition, which collides head on with the ethical parameters in the play. This lecture is the introductory lecture discussing the tragedy of Macbeth. So guys, we have to understand the plot of the play properly. Listen the next part of the lecture carefully to have a fair idea about the plot of the play. Both English and Bengali versions of the play is offered there for your better understanding of the storyline.
During the next half an hour, we are going to be discussing William Shakespeare's well-known tragedy, Macbeth. As we know, William Shakespeare was an Elizabethan poet playwright. That is, he lived and wrote most of his poems and plays during the time of the Tudor monarch Elizabeth I. He is widely considered one of the greatest dramatists in English. Speaking on the fecundity of Shakespeare's imagination, Alexander Dumas, the French writer, said, "After God, Shakespeare has created most. It is about a regicide and its aftermath. In other words, it is the story of an ambitious, conscience-stricken, and imaginative general who is driven by his wife or by his ambition to murder his king." Let us now explore the characteristics of Shakespeare's tragedies. As in classical tragedies, Shakespeare's tragic heroes are men of high state and noble status. In Macbeth, the protagonist is a Scottish general. He is also a close relative of King Duncan. King Lear. Lear is a king of Britain. and Hamlet is the prince of Denmark. The plot of a tragedy is about the evils that befall a conspicuous person like this. Another feature of Shakespeare's tragedies is that they end in the deaths of both the hero and the heroine. In Macbeth, both Macbeth and Lady Macbeth die. This is also true of plays like Romeo and Juliet. Both the hero and the heroine die at the end of the play. The dramatis personae of Macbeth include Duncan, King of Scotland, Malcolm, Duncan's eldest son, Donald Bain, Duncan's youngest son, Macbeth, a general in King Duncan's army. He was originally the Thane of Glamis, then Thane of Cawdor, and later King of Scotland. Lady Macbeth, Macbeth's wife and later Queen of Scotland. Banquo, Macbeth's friend and a general in King Duncan's army. Fleance, Banquo's son. Macduff, Thane of Fife. Lady Macduff, Macduff's wife, Macduff's son. Then we have the Scottish Thanes, Ross, Lennox, Angus, Menteith, and Caithness. We have Stuart, Earl of Northumberland, and General of the English Forces. Young Stuart, who is Stuart's son. Satan, Macbeth's servant. Hecate, goddess of witchcraft. And the three witches who predict that Macbeth will become a king. Macbeth opens amidst thunder and lightning. The three witches, or the weird sisters, agree that their next meeting shall be with Macbeth. As the scene changes, a wounded sergeant reports to King Duncan that Macbeth, one of the king's kinsmen, and Banquo, another general, have just defeated the combined armies of Norway and Ireland, which were led by the traitor Macdonwald. Everyone praises Macbeth's loyalty, bravery, and fighting prowess. The passage is quite ironic. It is ironic because soon Macbeth will also turn out to be a traitor like Macdonwald. When the scene changes, Macbeth and Banquo enter, talking about the weather and their victory in the battle. Soon, the three witches greet them with their prophecies on a lonely heath. The first witch hails Macbeth as a Thane of Glamis. The second hails him as a Thane of Cawdor. The third witch hails him the king that shall be hereafter. As Macbeth appears to be stunned to silence, Banquo challenges them. They prophesy that Banquo's descendants will be kings, though he himself will not be one. Soon, message arrives that the title of Thane of Cawdor has been bestowed upon Macbeth. Thus, the first of the witch's prophecies is fulfilled. This functions as a trigger for the rest of the action in the play. Macbeth is brooding. It seems that he has already made up his mind to become the King of Scotland. He sends a message to his wife, Lady Macbeth. The message talks about the witch's prophecies. When King Duncan decides to stay at the Macbeth's castle at Inverness, Lady Macbeth hatches a plot to murder King Duncan and secure the throne for her husband. Macbeth is a little apprehensive about regicide, but his wife succeeds in persuading her husband to follow her plan. He murders Duncan, but he's so shaken that Lady Macbeth has to take charge. She places the daggers on Duncan's sleeping guards so as to frame them. Early in the morning, Lennox, a Scottish nobleman, and Macduff, the loyal Thane of Fife, arrive. A drunken porter opens the entrance of the castle. In his state of drunkenness, he thinks that he is the porter of the gates of hell. This situation is also quite ironic. The murder of Duncan has just occurred, and Macbeth's castle has become literally a hell. Macbeth leads the noblemen into the castle, and Macduff enters Duncan's chamber. He discovers Duncan's corpse. In a feigned fit of anger, Macbeth kills both the guards before they get a chance to proclaim their innocence. Macduff is suspicious of Macbeth, but he does not express his suspicions openly. He has to be politically correct. Fearing for their lives, Duncan's sons also flee from the land. Malcolm to England and Donalbain to Ireland. Being the closest relative of King Duncan, who is in Scotland, Macbeth ascends the throne. Macbeth is uneasily conscious of the witch's prophecy about Banquo and his descendants. He invites Banquo to a royal banquet. He learns that Banquo and his son Fleance are to ride out that night. He hires assassins to kill them. The assassins succeed in killing Banquo, but Fleance escapes. Meanwhile, at the banquet, Macbeth and Lady Macbeth invite the lords of the country to a night of drinking and merriment. At this point, Banquo's ghost enters and sits in Macbeth's place. Macbeth grows furious, but only he can see the ghost. It is a subjective ghost. The others panic when the king rages at an empty chair. But now Lady Macbeth takes control of the situation. She tells the guests that her husband has been suffering from a harmless malady. A disturbed Macbeth visits the three witches again. Remember that this time he seeks out the witches. They conjure up three spirits with three prophecies and warnings. An alarmed head tells Macbeth to beware of Macduff. A bloody child warns, "None born of woman shall harm Macbeth." A crowned child holding a tree states that Macbeth will never be vanquished until Great Birnam Wood comes to High Dunsinane Hill. Macbeth is lulled into a false sense of security by the witch's ambiguous words. He is informed that Macduff is in exile in England. So he orders the execution of Macduff's wife and child. Lady Macbeth collapses psychologically from the guilt of the crimes she and her husband have committed. She walks in sleep and tries to wash away imaginary blood stains. The sleepwalking scene is one of the most memorable in the whole of Shakespeare. In England, Macduff is told about the slaughter of his family. In Scotland, Macbeth is increasingly seen as a tyrant. Malcolm leads an army, also joined by Macduff, and Seward the Senior, the Earl of Northumberland. When the army is camped in the Birnam Wood, the soldiers are asked to cut down and hold tree limbs in order to camouflage their numbers. Thus, the witch's first prophecy is fulfilled. Meanwhile, Macbeth learns about the death of his wife. Then he delivers a soliloquy on the futility of life. A soliloquy is a dramatic device by which an actor expresses his thoughts and feelings. The purpose of a soliloquy is to convey the thoughts and feelings to the audience. In the battle that follows, Macduff confronts Macbeth. Macbeth boasts that he does not fear Macduff because no one born of woman will be able to harm Macbeth. Macduff declares that he was prematurely ripped from his mother's womb. That is, he was born of cesarean section. In this way, the witch's second prophecy is also fulfilled. Macbeth realizes too late that he has misinterpreted the witch's words, or they have deliberately misled him. Macduff beheads Macbeth, and the first prophecy is also fulfilled. Malcolm is placed on the throne of Scotland. Then what happens to the witch's prophecy about Banquo and his descendants? James VI of Scotland, who assumed the throne of England as James I, was supposedly a descendant of Banquo. Let us now explore the major themes of the play Macbeth. What is the play ultimately about? The play Macbeth has attracted much scholarship and many speculations. Some scholars see Macbeth as Shakespeare's compliment to King James I. These scholars tell us that Shakespeare sought to flatter King James I by developing the story of Macbeth. King James I traced his descent to Banquo, an imaginary Scottish gentleman of the 11th century. The king must have been pleased by the ancient supernatural predictions of his glory. Secondly, Shakespeare's characterization of the witches in the play also must have pleased the king, because the depiction of the witches corresponds exactly to the king's belief in witches, as he put it in the scholarly treatise Demonology. Shakespeare presents the witches as wrinkled, ugly women who have sold their souls to the devil for the gift of prophecy. Seeking and accepting the help of the witches, Macbeth is also partly guilty of trafficking with the devil. So in a way, Macbeth is about man's bondage to evil. Other scholars see the play as the exploration of the mind of a killer. They go to the extent of calling Macbeth a butcher and Lady Macbeth a fiend. They admire the profound character studies offered by Shakespeare. With great dramatic skill and profound psychological insight, Shakespeare presents Macbeth as a victim of criminal ambition. There is nothing wrong with ambition. But in Macbeth's case, it is an ambition to seek and possess what is not his. Even before Macbeth meets the witches, this ambition is inherent in him. In fact, the slumbering ambition makes him more amenable to the witches' suggestion. This is clear from Macbeth's response to the witches' prophecies. He listens to them with rapt attention. He broods over the prophecies. He is also anxious about the prophecies. The course of action suggested by ambition is perilous. Soon it becomes a passion. We know that Macbeth murders the king in order to secure the throne for himself. Many critics view Macbeth as a historical play which deals with the punishment for treason. But Macbeth is insecure in his ambition even after he secures the throne for himself. The murder of Banquo is undertaken partly from the resentment that the fruit of his labors should be enjoyed by Banquo's descendants. Macbeth embarks upon an orgy of crime and murders Macduff's wife and children. A few critics prefer to call Macbeth a Christian tragedy which traces in detail the damnation of the soul. Many have detected in it the elements of a morality play. The potter in the play also speaks in the Calvinistic fashion of damnation. Macbeth is ridden with guilt. Despondency overwhelms him. He cries out in agony and despair. He cannot find meaning or purpose anywhere in life. This is surely the most harrowing vision of spiritual isolation ever to be realized in drama. The disastrous consequences of Macbeth's ambition are not limited to him. During Shakespeare's time, people, including King James, believed in the divine right theory of kingship. The king was considered the regent or deputy of God on the earth. Thus, rebellion against or murder of the king was considered not only a crime against the state, but also a sin committed against God. From the moment of King Duncan's murder, Scotland is portrayed as a country shaken by the inversions of the natural order. Scotland experiences violent weather conditions. The witches' lines in the first act, "Fair is foul and foul is fair," summarizes the inversion of order. Hierarchies are tampered with. The great chain of being is upset. Moral and political degradation is paralleled by perturbations in nature. Among the inversions of the natural order is a disturbance of sleep. In the regular order of nature, one part of the day is meant for work and the other part is meant for sleep. But after Macbeth murders Duncan, he hears a voice saying that Macbeth has murdered sleep. This statement is figuratively mirrored in Lady Macbeth's sleepwalking. Supernatural elements abound in Macbeth. The three witches, called the Weird Sisters, and Banquo's ghost are the two notable examples of the supernatural. Shakespeare's depiction of the witches follows contemporary belief. In the play, they represent forces of darkness, chaos, and conflict. But are they capable of originating evil in men? The question is, are they mere witness to evil or are they agents of evil? It is true that the witches' prophecies lead Macbeth to murderous thoughts. But it is also true that he has this inclination to do evil even before he meets the witches. After he meets the witches, this temptation to do evil takes a concrete shape. In fact, the witches approach Macbeth because they know that he is more amenable to their suggestions than Banquo. Of course, the witches' prophecies and equivocal statements lead him to his ultimate doom. Their prophecies are morally neutral. Macbeth has the full freedom to choose his course of action. In other words, he has free will. Shakespeare's versatile genius has given the world a wide variety of heroes and heroines. They have a certain depth and complexity. As a result, they are subjects of perennial interest. The character of Macbeth is presented in a progressive manner, a downward progress from good to bad and from bad to worse. Throughout this process of deterioration, Macbeth is shown as intensely human, essentially noble and good, and yet susceptible to evil. Consequently, the character of Macbeth is realistic and credible. Though at the end of the play, Macbeth has become a monstrously wicked man, he is not a morally cold villain who deliberately chooses evil for his god. Until Macbeth yields to the temptation of becoming the king himself, he is known for his loyalty and bravery. People talk about these qualities of his. Even after he has embarked upon his career of crime, he is constantly plagued by his conscience. He has a very sensitive conscience, and this sensitive conscience makes him hate every act of evil as he commits it. He tries to stifle the warnings of his conscience, but he cannot suppress the warnings entirely. Macbeth's physical courage stands in sharp contrast to his moral cowardice. Due to this moral cowardice, he is unable to resist his wife's desire to make him the king and commit Duncan's murder. He commits the subsequent murders with less agitation. It is this moral cowardice which makes Macbeth a tyrant as the plot advances. He becomes distrustful, treacherous, and cruel. We have already seen that the cause of this moral cowardice is Macbeth's excessive ambition. Ambition is one trait that defines Macbeth's character. Closely linked to Macbeth's excessive ambition is his capacity for lively imagination. He sees the air-drawn dagger which seems to move towards King Duncan's chamber. He also sees a vision of Banquo's ghost. A.C. Bradley, who has written on Shakespeare's tragedy, says that it is through imagination that Macbeth is kept in touch with supernatural impressions. It is also through his imagination that Macbeth is made liable to supernatural fears. All the intimations of conscience and honor come to Macbeth through his imagination. In fact, his better nature expresses itself through his imagination. It is Bradley's contention that if Macbeth had obeyed only his imagination, he would have been safe. But Macbeth's imagination also becomes the instrument by which Nemesis avenges the crime. In comparison with Macbeth, Lady Macbeth appears only a few times in the play. Yet, our understanding of her character is quite comprehensive. Lady Macbeth is one of those commanding, awe-inspiring figures whom one finds in Shakespeare once in a while. She is called the Clytemnestra of English tragedy. She is as ambitious as her husband, but she is more practical in attaining the object of her ambition. This is evident from her response to the witch's prediction. Macbeth is somebody who listens to the witch's prediction firsthand, but he experiences a conflict in his mind regarding what to do. The prediction is only reported to Lady Macbeth, but the flame of ambition possesses her in a moment, and she starts working on the realization of that ambition. Lady Macbeth also has an inflexible will that keeps or appears to keep her imagination, conscience, and feeling in check. She knows her husband's weaknesses. She also knows that she has to goad her husband into committing the murder. Lady Macbeth has a hypnotizing effect on her husband. She displays great self-control and presence of mind even in moments of great danger and horror, as in the murder scene and the banquet scene. Her resourceful practical intelligence makes her behave in a calm manner. But it is her excessive willpower which proves to be her ruin as well. Her imperious will makes her impose upon herself and bear a strain which is beyond the endurance of the rest of her powers. Soon her resistance collapses and she becomes a nervous wreck. In other words, she collapses psychologically because she has artificially hardened her otherwise tender nature. In the memorable sleepwalking scene, we see how memories of the murders of Duncan, Banquo,